96-24.
All right, welcome back to the Fast Money Halftime Report. Yeah. We are welcoming in Eric Sprott now. He is CEO of Sprott Asset Management. Before we get to your investing strategy, I want to take a look at what's happening in commodities. Obviously, you're a big player in the commodity space, but take a look at, you know, gold today is down below 1,600. You've got oil barely hanging on to 96 bucks. So it's an interesting story in the commodities market today, given those concerns about global growth, Pete. What you're seeing in commodities.
Absolutely, and I look at some of these commodity names right now and I find them very, very interesting and actually quite, in many cases, I think appealing because the sell-off has been so harsh. I mean, we're talking about looking for opportunities. It's not just in some of the broad sectors of the market like you're talking about technology, maybe it's financials, I'm not seeing it in the financials, but certainly when you look at some of these commodities, the way they've been sold off, whether you're looking over in the copper space, I think there's some great opportunities, as well as in the met coal, where they continue to pound on it, but at some level, it seems to me that it gets very, very attractive from the global perspective.
Yeah, let's switch and talk to gold now with Eric Sprott, because you have made it really the central theme of your investing thesis.
Right.
Gold is down today. It's been performing weird lately. I think you'd agree with that. And
yes.
I think that's an appropriate word as well. I want to read something that you said in April of this year. I would have thought that with Europe teetering on the brink of bankruptcy, it would have had been good for gold, but for some reason, gold has been under pressure. So clearly that statement could be made today,
yes,
and it would hold true. Last year was a difficult year for you in that strategy. We know what happened with gold towards the end of the year.
Right.
Why is now all of a sudden going to be different if the same thing you said a month ago could be said as we sit here today at Salt?
Well, Scott, I think you have to go back to how we got into the crisis. You know, I think we had an over-levered banking system. I'm going back to the NASDAQ crash, if you will. And really, when the Lehman event indicated the over-leverage of the financial system, its liquidation created nothing but chaos. And subsequently, the powers that be, whether it's the ECB or the Fed or the Bank of Japan, have made every attempt not to let this thing unravel. And therefore, people on the surface can't maybe see what the underlying problems are. But we had the Greece failure. I would suggest that with Spanish yields over 6%, it might be the next one to fall. And I always go back to, if you were in Greece or you're in Ireland or you're in Argentina one time, would you have been taking your money out of the bank and would you have purchased gold? And I have to believe it's happening. We have some wonderful statistics on physical gold purchases, which argue very strongly for the price of gold to go up.
Why isn't gold up today? On a day like this, when there was so much seeming fear in the market, you would typically think that you would see a flight to gold, as you're seeing a flight to treasuries, you see the 10-year yield falling.
Right.
What's going on?
Well, I think it's counterintuitive. Gold normally doesn't go up when things are the most extreme. When we had the LTRO announcement on Feb 29th, it got crashed, which seemed somewhat counterintuitive. I mean, I'm going to fall back on Jim Grant's statement here on CNBC when he said, you know, all markets are manipulated. And we know the credit markets are manipulated. I suspect that central banks that are fighting this contagion out there don't like gold going up. So I think it's always somewhat counterintuitive. The people who sell paper gold and paper silver can rule the markets over the short term. But I think in the long run, the physical participants will win the day.
So you're not deviating at all from your strategy. And I should note for all of you watching this conversation that Mr. Sprott has made a 17.1% annualized return since the inception of the fund in 2002. So clearly your strategy has worked. You've had some ups and some downs, clearly. But you're not changing your strategy at all. In fact, you've called silver the investment of the next decade.
Correct. I'll tell you why I haven't changed my mind on gold, first of all. I mean, there was a data point that came out yesterday where the exports of gold from Hong Kong into mainland China went up 600% year over year in the month of March. In the last 9 months, really ever since LTRO started, the Chinese have been buying massive amounts of gold. Most people wouldn't recognize the significance of 64 tons, but if I told you that mine supply, ex-China and ex-Russia, because none of that ever makes the market, is only 2,200 tons a year, when all of a sudden you buy 64 tons in a month, that's a significant part of the mining market. And I was a little surprised that gold reacted negatively yesterday, because I think the physical data is overwhelmingly in favor of gold.
year-end target for gold is what?
Well, I think it'll go over 2,000 by year-end.
And silver?
I think it'll go back over $50 by year end.
Well, I'd love to broaden the conversation and just get your thoughts, both Pete and Pierre, on what you're hearing here. I don't know what sort of position or what your view is on metals, on gold in general, Pierre.
Well, I think I don't have a very strong view on gold, but what I can observe is that it's a little bit like the S&P movement today, for instance. People are hiding in there. A lot of people are buying gold because they're scared and they're hiding in there. And if you ask them much more how to legitimate why they're buying, they don't really have a clue. And at the same time, a lot of the reason why they're scared is that, you know, you're going to get inflation from the action of the central bank. When you look at the output gap and you look at the severity of, you know, the destruction of large parts of economic growth, this is not today's battle. And yes, of course, we have to look at tomorrow's battle as well, but that's really been pushed a couple of years further out. And we first have to deal with a deflationary situation of spiraling down European economy and a slowing down world economy before we deal with the worries about inflation. So that removes a lot of the attraction of buying something that has had quite a lot of momentum in terms of ETFs and everybody piling up in it. It's a very intuitive reaction.
Let's also throw out the fact that I'm sure, Eric, over the last few days, you heard the comments, or at least read them, of what Warren Buffett and others said on CNBC. They're not fans of gold. No. Neither is Charlie Munger, neither is Bill Gates.
Right. But I find it really interesting, particularly with those three gentlemen making that comment. Gold was the investment of the last decade. It blew away any investment you could make, including Microsoft and Berkshire Hathaway, probably by a factor of 500%. So in other words, they missed the trade, big time. I don't know that I should respect their opinion at this point in time. I think all the evidence points to reasons to own gold. And yes, you can look at it as a non-interest paying asset. Gold went up 17% a year for 12 years now. Yes, it's in a bit of a funk at the present time. The year's not over, and the evidence seems to mount that the physical buyers are prepared to take the metal off the system. We had central banks come in and buy something like 58 tons in the month of February, way beyond what they bought the year before. And I might mention, these are non-G6 central banks. And I always believe there's unintended consequences to everything. And when the G6 had their unlimited swaps and you had the LTRO and the threat to print money, if you're not a G6 member but you're looking in, what are you thinking? What are you thinking of what's going on here? Do you really want to own a U.S. bond yielding 2% when they're printing money? Do you want to own a European bond when you realize the banking system is falling apart? And those non-G6 central banks have stepped up buying, as has China.
Pete, we talk about the SLV, talk about the GLD on a daily basis. Your thoughts?
We talk about it all the time. Last year we sat here at the SALT conference and the SLV was pushing at those very upper levels and accelerated to the upside. What is it right now about silver that excites you so much, that gets you onto that bandwagon? And also, is the SLV the proper instrument to use, or is there something else that you'd be using actually to trade silver?
You have an instrument
I'm
well, right? Now you're
going to
be talking. Now he's going to be talking his book.
Just curious, Eric.
Or maybe you're setting me up. Thank you very much. But we have our own trust, the PSLV, where the asset is in Canada. It's held by the Royal Canadian Mint, and people can exchange those trust units for the actual silver. And it has tax advantages over the SLV, so obviously I have to recommend that. Why do I think that silver will outperform gold? I look at two or three metrics that suggest that to me. As an example, last year, the U.S. Mint sold as many dollars of silver coins as gold coins, same dollar amount. In other words, people bought 50 times more physical silver than gold. When we did our last two tranches of the PHYS, our gold trust, and PSLV, our silver trust, both of them raised $349 million. We bought 50 times more silver than gold. We don't force people to buy these things, that's their decision. I don't force people to buy coins at the U.S. Mint, that's their decision. So if the common guy is going to buy silver in a ratio of 50 to 1 to gold, but it's only available at 6.5 to 1, I have to believe the price of silver is going to outperform gold.
Yep. All right, more with Eric Sprott on the other side of this break, including the areas he's short in the market. And later, as the yield on the 10-year cracks 1.8%, BlackRock's Rick Rieder will show you how he's playing it. More Halftime Report live from SALT in Vegas is next.
The Halftime Report is sponsored by Fidelity Investments. Turn here.